Well, good morning, everyone. How are you all this morning? Well, it is wonderful to see you all. I see lots of old faces. I see some new faces. So let me introduce myself to those of you that don't know me. My name is Teresa Eamon, and this is my 10th year of having the privilege to sing here at Warbirds in Review. If you're sitting here wondering what's going on, this is one of the best things that you can do every day. And every day, at 20 minutes into the hour, there'll be reenactors talking about whatever time period is represented by the airplanes. And then when they're done, I come up and I sing. And then at the top of the hour, 10 o'clock and 1 o'clock, it's a program with interviews and conversations about whatever airplane is being displayed. And at today, it is the de Havilland Beaver. But each day and each time, there will be different airplanes for you to enjoy. So if you're watching live or if you're watching online, welcome to you. I encourage you to join us every day. And for the next little while, I'm going to sing songs that are representative of the era of the Beaver. We'll occasionally be interrupted by a round engine. In this case, it's the beautiful Old Crow over there in Mustang Row. But I'm going to start out with a song that I think is perfect to begin EAA Air Venture. This is a song called Come Fly With Me. Little volume issue here for me. There we go.
Come fly with me, let's fly away. If you can use some exotic booze, there's a bar in far Bombay. Come fly with me, let's fly away. Come fly with me, we'll float down to Peru. In Lama Land, there's a one-man band, and he'll toot his flute for you. Come fly with me, we'll float down to the blue. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide, starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so near. You may hear angels cheer because we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a lovely day. Just say those words and we'll beat those birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. So come fly with me, let's fly away. Oh yeah. You up there where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so near. You may hear all the angels cheer because we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a lovely day. You just say those words and we'll beat those birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. So come fly with me, let's fly, we'll fly. Pack up, let's fly away.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I appreciate that. This particular plane we're looking at is actually, for the most part, post-World War II. So we're going to be hearing music from between like 1947 to 1967. And this next song is one that Ella Fitzgerald recorded in 1956. It's a little bit older than that, but this particular version came out smack dab in the middle of when this plane was flying. This is a song called All the Things You Are. You are the promised kiss of springtime that makes the lonely winter seem long. You are the breathless hush of evening that trembles on the brink of a lovely song. You are the angel glow that lights the star. The dearest things I know are what you are. Someday my happy arms will hold you, and someday I'll know that moment divine when all the things you are mine. You are the promised kiss of springtime that trembles on the brink of a lovely song. You are the angel glow that lights a star. The dearest things I know are what you are. Will hold you, and someday I'll know that moment divine when all the things you are mine. But thank you very much. Thank you. Now, this next song is one that I think a lot of you will recognize. This one was recorded in 1966 by a wonderful British singer named Petula Clark. And I have never sung this song here before, so I'm super excited to sing it for you. It's a song called Downtown.
Oh. When you're alone and life is making you lonely, you can always go downtown. When you've got worries, all the noise and the hurry seems to help, I know. Downtown, just listen to the music of the traffic of the city. Linger on the sidewalk where the neon signs are pretty. How can you lose? The lights are much brighter there. You can forget all your troubles, forget all your cares, and go downtown. Things will be great when you're downtown. No finer place for sure. Downtown, everything's waiting for you. Don't hang around and let your problems surround you. There are movie shows downtown. Maybe you know some little places to go where they never close. Downtown, just listen to the rhythm of a gentle bossa nova. You'll be dancing with them too before the night is over. Happy again. The light are much brighter there. You can forget all your troubles, forget all your cares, and go downtown, where all the lights are bright. Downtown, waiting for you tonight. Downtown, you're gonna be all right now. And you may find somebody kind to help and understand you. Someone who is just like you and needs a gentle hand to guide them along. So maybe I'll see you there. You can forget all your troubles, forget all your cares, and go downtown. Things will be great when you're downtown. Don't wait a minute more. Downtown, everything's waiting for you. This is downtown.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Now, very early in the 1950s, one of America's greatest entertainers and singers was stepping on the stage, and this is probably his most famous song, and one that I think you guys will all enjoy. This is Can't Help Falling in Love.
Wise men say only fools rush in, but I can't help falling in love with you. Shall I stay? Would it be if I can't help falling in love with you? Like a river flows surely to the sea, darling, so it goes. Some things are meant to be. Take my hand, take my whole life too, for I can't. like the river flows surely to the sea. Darling, so it goes. Some things are meant to be. Take my hand, take my whole life too, for I can't help falling in love with you, for can't help falling in love with you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Now, this next song is a Nat King Cole song, and it's a great tune. And it talks about one of the paint colors on the beautiful plane behind us. This is a song called Orange Colored Sky.
I was walking along, minding my business, when out of the orange-colored sky, flash, bam, alakazam, wonderful you came by. I was humming a tune, drinking in sunshine, when out of that orange-colored hue, flash, bam, alakazam, I gotta look at you. One look and I yelled, timber, watch out for flying glass. But the ceiling fell in and the bottom went out. I went into a spin and I started to shout, this is it, this is it, this is it. I was walking along, minding my business, when love came and hit me in the eye. Flash, bam, alakazam, out of the orange colored sky. One look and I yelled, timber, watch out for flying glass. 'Cause the ceiling fell in and the bottom went out. I went into a spin and I started to shout, this is it, this is it, this is it. I was walking along, minding my business, when love came and hit me in the eye. Flash, bam, alakazam, out of the orange color, purple stripe, pretty green polka dot sky.
I appreciate that. Whoops, we're not doing that one again. All righty. Now, this next song is by one of my new favorite singers from the 1950s and early 60s. Brenda Lee, I think, is very under-regarded. I think she was an amazing singer. And everybody knows the song, I'm Sorry, but she's also recorded a lot of other great tunes. Hold on a second. I got to fix this thing because it's poking me in the bad spot. There we go. And hold on. This is a logistical issue. Day one, everything's got to get fixed. This one is what I think is a lovely love song. It was recorded by Brenda Lee, and then in the late 70s, Juice Newton recorded it. But many of you might know it. This is a song called Break It to Me Gently. The band is very tired today, apparently. We need to wake them up. Well, I'm about to do something because something's not working here.
Break it to me gently. Let me down the easy way. Make me feel that you still love me. If it's just for one more day. Break it to me gently, so my tears don't fall too fast. If you must go, then go slowly. Let me love you till the last. The love we shared for oh so long is such a big part of me. If you must take your love away, take it gradually. To me gently, give me time, oh, give me a little time to ease the pain. Love me just a little longer, 'cause I'll never love again. 'Cause I'll never love again.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Now, this next song is a song that I like to sing because I'm just awfully glad that we're here and back enjoying Air Venture like we have in the past. And I'm always happy to start these shows. And this is a Judy Garland tune that was recorded in 1961. This is called Get Happy. Better chase all your cares away. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. Get ready for the judgment day. The sun is shining, come on, get happy. The Lord is waiting to take your hand. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. We're going to the promised land. We're heading across the river. Wash your sins away in the tide. It's oh so peaceful on the other side. Forget your troubles and just get happy. You better chase all your cares away. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. Get
ready for the judgment day.
Dancing was such an integral part of the music of this time period. I wish I was better.
Oh, we're headed across the river. Wash your sins away in the tide. It's oh so peaceful on the other side. Forget your troubles and just get happy. We're gonna chase all your cares away. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Get ready for the judgment day.
Thank you very much. Well, I have one more song for you. And if you're waiting for the 40 stuff, you're going to have to come this afternoon at 12:30, because all of everybody's favorites are a little bit earlier than this time period. And I'm trying to kind of cover songs that were popular during the time that this plane is represented. But this particular song has been on the pop charts more than once. And it's one that many shows usually ended with, especially this one by Nat King Cole. This is a song called Stardust.
And now the purple dust of twilight time steals across the meadows of my heart. High up in the sky, the little stars climb, always reminding me that we're apart. You wander down the lane and far away, leaving me a song that will not die. Love is now the stardust of yesterday, the music of the years gone by. Sometimes I spend the lonely night dreaming of a song. The melody haunts my reverie, and I am once again with you when our love was new, and each kiss an inspiration. But that was long ago, and now my consolation is in the stardust of a song. Beside a garden wall where stars are bright, you are in my arms. The nightingale tells his fairy tale of paradise where roses grew. Though I dream in vain, in my heart it always will remain my stardust. melody, the memory of love's refrain.
Thank you very much. Again, my name is Teresa Eman, and I just want to tell you, if you are enjoying the programming here throughout the week, there's an opportunity for you to become a member of Warbirds of America. You can do it right over there in the gift shop, and your membership helps support programs like these, plus many others. Also, I want to let you know that if you enjoy seeing this kind of stuff year-round, come talk to me a little bit about air-to-air and how you can watch content year-round, because I can tell you all about that. But until I'm back here at 12:30, I want to thank all of you very much for sitting and listening to me. The best part is just about to start. So please, if I don't see you the rest of the day, have a great time for the next hour and a great time the rest of the time you're here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Teresa. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being here, and thanks once again to Teresa. She does a wonderful job entertaining us prior to our main features of the days. Thanks again, Teresa. My name is Connie Bolin. I'm the founder and now the coordinator for Warbirds in Review, and we thank you. Wow, I have a fan club. This is wonderful. You've seen me so often that they say, oh boy, I see other people here that are going to heckle us. This is great. We have a tremendous crew to work this event, Sleeping Dog Productions and all of the camera people, our moderators, our volunteers, and of course the aircraft owners, restorers, pilots. This is the place to be because of all the people who step up and answer my calls when I say, would you like to be part of Warbirds in Review? And this is a good example this morning. Those of you who came to see a Lysander have figured out that this is obviously not a Lysander. This is a beaver that is a brand new restoration. So we put out the call when the Lysander's schedule changed and he could not be here today. He will be here on Thursday morning. So we put out the call to Gary Peters and said, you have a beautiful, unusual aircraft. Could you be part of Warbirds in Review? And they, on the last few minutes, have put together a video along with Scott Guyot with Sleeping Dog Productions. So we have a great show for you this morning with this beaver that you see behind me here. All of this would not be possible without the donations, the support of some of our sponsors. So I'll take a few minutes to say thank you to Scott's Miracle-Gro. Jim Hagedorn is our sustaining sponsor. Ron and Diane Fagan of Fagan Fighters World War II Museum in Granite Falls. They provide the building for us here that allows us production crew, the green room for our guests, and many other sponsors help us out with this. And of course, you being here makes it all worthwhile. We have a video here very shortly, and I'm going to ask Scott to play it. But then when the video is finished, our moderator for this year for most of the programs will be Ed McElhenney, General Retired U.S. Air Force. He's back here right now waiting to introduce our guests. They will all come on here after the video, so please enjoy, and thank you for being here.
If the Army has to move small teams a great distance within the battle area, it turns to the L-20 Beaver. For increasing demands for quick movement mean that more and more men of a ground army must move through the air. The Beaver gives the Army dependable transportation.
Hi, I'm Gary Peters with Hangar 180 in Lewiston, Idaho. I'd like to share with you a few details about our recently completed restoration project of a 1952 de Havilland beaver. This particular beaver has some kind of unique history. It was delivered in England in 1953 at the 81st Tactical Forward Wing. And, you know, it's just kind of fun because that same base in World War II was the home of Mustangs, then Spitfires, then F-86s, and then F-4s, and then ended its career with A-10 Thunderbolts. So it was kind of fun for us to know that this airplane, you know, actually had a purpose overseas. And so it's a real exciting but unique different warbird. So we're really excited to share this project with everyone. We're really happy how it turned out. Bill, I'll let you tell us a little bit about your project.
Okay, well, we found this airplane. It had been sitting in a hangar for a lot of years, and we brought it home and anyway decided to do a full-blown ground-up restoration on it. And all the sheet metal, the paint, interior, floorboards, everything was done in-house here by myself and my team, and we've just had a great time doing it. Tulsa Aircraft Engines found us a first-run 985 engine we put on it. It's only got 2,200 hours original, and so it's just been a lot of fun, and we can't wait to share it with you guys back at Oshkosh.
And again, that's the whole goal with like all of our airplanes. You know, we're just caretakers of them, and they're flying monuments. They're monuments so that we can remember, you know, why we're able to do these great things and why we're able to enjoy these amazing freedoms. And that's because of the veterans and the pilots that flew these, whether it was in the war or the Cold War or even today in training, preparing if they may get called to war. And so that's what these airplanes represent. And I think the Beaver has turned out really well.
Follow me. Grab a seat. Good morning, folks. I'm Ed McElhenney, and I'll briefly talk a little bit now. I'm the rudder that's going to navigate this ship. As far as I'm concerned, I shouldn't talk very much at all because these are the experts back here. You just saw in the video that the guy right to my left here, that's Gary Peters. He's the owner and the guy who made this thing happen, Bill Strange. And then, Bill is one of the restorers, primary restorer, if you will. And then the girl down, she's not here just to look good. No, she's one of the restorers also, okay? So she's here because, she actively participated in rebuilding this airplane and putting it the way it is. The Lysander is not here, as Connie said. It will be here on Thursday, but I saw this airplane come in, and when I looked at it up close, I said, oh my gosh, I said, we got to have this thing here. And oh, by the way, and I won't ask the question, but 75 years ago this August, this thing first flew. Not this airplane, but the Beaver. So this is the 75th anniversary of the Beaver, and it couldn't be any more appropriate than to have this beautiful, beautiful airplane here right now. And the way the program is going to run right now, we've got it for about an hour. Y'all don't have to stay that long. If you want to stay longer, we're going to open up to questions later, but we're going to talk a little bit about the airplane itself, talk about the acquisition of the airplane, talk about the restoration of the airplane. We've actually got a Air Force former second lieutenant, L-20 pilot in the audience that we'll talk to. He's 89 years, no, I guess he's not quite 89 years old, right? Okay, he's 88 right now, but we may let him tell a story or two. Then we'll do a quick walk around, then we'll open it up to questions. So that's kind of what we're going to try to do today, and I'll open it up right now to Gary Peters, like I said, the owner and the guy who made this thing happen. And I'll just say right now, I thought it was really neat when I talked to him a couple days ago. He said, hey, when I got into this thing, I wanted to get into a family warbird. That's why I bought this thing. And so, Gary, I'm going to turn it over to you right now, and you can make the first introductions here.
All right. Well, thanks, Ed. And thanks, everybody, for coming out this morning to kick off Oshkosh. We're excited to be here and share our story about our recently completed Beaver restoration. So as Ed mentioned, you know, as for those of you that are into warbirds, there's not a lot of options to get a family warbird and, you know, to bomb around on a B-25 or a or a C-47 or anything like that. It gets a little expensive, so that kind of narrowed our search. And what really got us interested in the Beaver was some real good friends of ours that many of you have probably heard of, the Pemberton family in Spokane, Washington. They're known for their aviation work all across the world. They restored a goose about 6 or 7 years ago, and they brought that goose down to our air show in 2017. And I had not spent much time on the water in either a float plane or a flying boat. And all it takes is one trip out on the water in an amphib or a flying boat, and you're pretty well hooked. And that airplane was so fun. That immediately accelerated our search for the Beaver. And we kind of narrowed it down to something that was a little more simpler than the goose to operate and maintain, because we have a fleet of other airplanes that we look after, and so we didn't want to overload ourselves. And so we kind of fell in love with the Beaver after that air show and started our search and zeroed in on that aircraft.
As I said, you know, the thing is 75 years old, and okay, you described why you were intrigued by the particular model, but then the actual acquisition, where did that come from?
So it's kind of interesting. So, you know, it was advertised in a trade plane a couple years before that, and it looked like it was advertised with flip phone photos taken from about a quarter mile away. You could barely tell it was an amphib beaver in the back of this hangar. And I had taken a photograph of that ad on my phone and saved it, and I had called on this airplane probably 20 times and never got any response and kind of gave up on it. And then when the goose came down, it kind of charged my batteries again to give it another run. So I made one more phone call, and I'll be darned if the guy didn't pick up. And he picked up, and I said, "Hey, do you still have a Beaver for sale?" And I won't use the exact words, but he said, "Where in the heck did you see that?" And I said, "Oh, I saw it in a trader plane a few years ago." And he said, "I haven't advertised that thing for 3 years." And I said, "Well, we're really interested. We kind of want a project, and you know, we're looking for something with these particular floats." And it was close. It was in north of Seattle, a little town called Linden, Washington. And he said, "I'll tell you what." He said, "This is the first time I've been in Seattle in 19 years in August. I'll meet you there tomorrow. I'm picking up crab pots for my king crab boat in Alaska. I'll meet you tomorrow, and you have 1 hour." And he said, "If we don't have a deal in 1 hour, lose my phone number." And I said, "Okay, fair enough. We get it." And so we hopped in the 206. We flew over to Linden, this little fly-in community. And we met him at this, and this Mike ends up being just a wonderful man. And we met him. We went inside. We looked at the Beaver for about an hour. It was exactly what we wanted. It hadn't seen daylight in 19 years. Interior was falling out. The tires were rotted off of it. But it was all there, you know, and you didn't have to source everything. And we made him an offer, and Mike said, "You know what? That's the first fair offer. You own the airplane." And he said the hangar rent's paid through November, which gave us about 3 months. And he said, "Have it out by November." And we said, "Okay, great." So we went home. We loaded up a service truck with what we felt we needed. And Bill and another friend of ours named Richard Witt, who helps maintain the airplanes, they drove over and they worked on the airplane for 2 days. And it was kind of funny. This flying community is just beautiful, and it's like the width of a highway with houses. In fact, when you taxi, your wings are over people's fences. And so everyone heard there was an amphibious beaver in this hangar, but no one had seen it because all the homes have been built after the hangar. And so it was kind of like a mystery to everyone. And so when they pulled the Beaver out, all the people from their houses came out and wanted to help, and it was really fun. So Bill got it pre-oiled and checked over, and it fired right up, believe it or not, and ran it. And the prop governor leaked like a sieve, and the fuel pump leaked like a sieve. So he came home. We had those rebuilt, went back over, worked on it 2 more days, and then we jumped in it and flew it home back to Lewiston, Idaho.
Wow. Wow. Okay, so that got it to Lewiston, okay? And then from there, obviously, it was grounded for how long?
So we got it to Lewiston, and as it turns out, we're in the heavy equipment business, is how we make our living, and so we had an old truck shop down by the port of Clarkston, and there happened to be a boat launch that was about 4 inches wide enough to run this up the boat launch. So we landed there, ran it up the boat launch, drove down the highway about a half a mile, pulled into the gate, pulled up to this old truck shed, and parked it the next morning, popped the wings off, backed it in. So it lived in that truck shed for nearly 3 years. and we only used it as a winter project. Like I said, in the meantime, we had to maintain our other airplanes, so it was just going to be a winter project for us for, we figured, about 5 years or 6 years. And then, of course, when COVID happened in 20, you know, a lot of our flying with the other airplanes and obligations, you know, went away, and so we were able to spend more time on the Beaver. And then as we got further into it, we hated to pull off of it because when you do that, you know, it takes you a month to figure out where you were before. So we said, you know what, let's just jump in it. Let's bang it out. Let's get it done. And the timing kind of started to work out for Oshkosh. And we thought, hey, this will be a good opportunity for us to come experience Oshkosh and share the airplane with everyone. And so we've really been going at it hard for about the last 6 months to try and get it done.
Okay. I got to ask Bill, how familiar were you with Beavers? Did you know very much about the airplane? Had you worked on other Beavers, or was this all of a sudden ready, set, go, and you get the books out and you start reading?
Yep, this was number one.
Wow.
So I got to jump in. I got to brag on Bill for a second. So most all of our guys are ex-crop duster mechanics, or a lot of our pilots that fly our Warbirds are all crop duster pilots, and people just don't realize the skill these guys have. I mean, when you're doing 60 or 70 landings per day on a 15-foot wide strip with a quartering tailwind, overgrowth coming in empty, and the same rings true with the mechanics. I mean, Bill's used to getting a phone call in the middle of the night. Hey, I lost a cylinder on a 1340. I'm out in the middle of a summer follow field, and I got a wingtip and a prop when I went in, but I got 600 acres to do by the end of the week. They go out in the middle of the night and hang a 1340 and a prop on and maybe repair a wing or splice a fuselage. So I just can't say enough of the talent these guys had, you know, to get this done. So anyway.
We talked about the family aspect of this. What did your family think of this project that you had? And your family is here, right?
So there's my wife and Charlie and Piper, my two youngest daughters. Stand up real quick, guys. Wave. Yep.
Were they all in on this?
Oh, yeah. And then Tyler and then Kenny and his wife, Barb. Right? Kenny was responsible for, he built the interior of this entire airplane, set up his sewing machine right in the shop in Lewiston and built everything right there. So Kenny and Barb came with us as well. But, yeah, they were really in on it because after you buy a couple single-seat Warbirds, they're ready for a family machine.
In fact, I understand.
I think she said the next airplane you buy better have room for us.
Well done.
Oh, yeah.
And then Tyler, how this isn't something that girls like you normally do. How did you get involved with this whole process?
Well, I grew up farming, and so I'm always hands-on work type of stuff, and that's what my family does. And then one day I was kind of just lost what I was pretty much going to do for a career, and then I sat down with my dad and Jill, and we had a long talk, and I wanted to learn how to fly, and so I was like, hey, let's give it a shot working at the hangar, learn how to be an aircraft mechanic. And by the end of the week, I was hooked, and I was like, time to get my AMP. And so I'm learning from Bill. I've been there for about a year and a half. So I caught the bug.
Wow. And you're flying, obviously, also. And so you're not only working, but you're flying airplanes.
Yeah, I got my private last October.
Okay.
And we made her solo in a L4 before we handed it off to the 172. So she soloed in a 1942 L4. And so she's getting her tailwheel time first.
I have a funny feeling this is just the start, too. Just the start. There's more to come. All right, let's get into the rebuild, Bill. I got to ask, here's this airplane. Hadn't flown in a long time. You got a ferry permit. You got it in there. And now where do you start? I have no idea.
We just jumped in with both feet, and started. Originally, we didn't know it was going to be a full-blown restoration, maybe just spruce it up a little bit. And like all restorations, it just got out of hand from there. And next thing you know, let's replace this skin. And by the time it was done, we had reskinned the entire fuselage.
Okay. And how many guys and gals did you have working with you? How many were on the team, if you will?
At that time, it was myself and a retired guy that I used to work with that Guston Aviation. And before we took this on, I said, if Richard's willing to help me and climb back through the back of that, and he's 72 years old, and if he wants to get in there and buck rivets, and he and I team up on it, I said, let's take it on. And I called Richard, and he was sitting at home saying, heck yeah, put me in.
Wow.
And so off we went.
Wow. So the exterior skin is all new, basically.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
So that's all new. How about, let's talk about engines. Where'd that come from? Was it hard to find? I mean, there's a lot of these things currently flying all over the world.
Right.
And so where'd you go with that?
So the engine that was on it had 800 hours on it and had some rust inside that we were, once we tore in to see. And so we decided we were going to put a new engine on it. And then we'd talk to Rex from Tulsa Aircraft Engines. And anyway, we were going to have him build one. And then next thing you know, he calls and he's like, hey, I just found 10 first run 985s in a warehouse in Chicago. And it'd be a great engine for you. 2,000 hours on it, never been rebuilt. So this will be the first rebuild on it. And so Gary jumped on that. And so there we were with a first run engine.
Wow. And that's what's in it right now.
That's the engine that's in it.
Okay. And so the story is that you flew from Lewiston here 1,200 miles. And I thought it was just one quart, but as it turned out, it was actually 2 quarts of oil that it burned, huh?
Yeah. And the real quarts, not a Pratt & Whitney quart.
Put a quart in it after about 6 hours, and it's maybe almost a quart low now.
Okay. So, how about other parts? Hard to come by? Are they available or expensive?
I was going to say, all you need to find parts for a Beaver is a checkbook.
That's it. Okay. Well, they stopped making them a long time ago, I know that, but there's still, like I said, a lot of them flying out there. And as long as we're talking about the rebuild, most difficult part of the rebuild, what do you think?
Birdcage.
Birdcage struts, so all of the front structure is all new in it. Basically, the airplane was gone from the back of the front doors forward.
Wow.
There was nothing on there.
Wow.
And getting all that fit, getting everything back, controls and everything back through that. De Havilland, their maintenance manuals are great as far as in detail and as far as setting up trims and stuff is probably the most detailed maintenance manuals I've ever used.
Huh. And did you have to contact De Havilland at all? I mean,
No, just, a few pieces, sourcing stuff through Viking Air and Ken Moore out of Seattle.
Okay.
You can buy all the sheet metal repair pieces from them, but Bill made every piece of sheet metal himself on a plywood bench with different diameters of steel pipe and rolled every piece of sheet metal himself.
Wow. And from what you said, Gary, this airplane was originally designated an L-20 and a U-6A.
Yeah, it was built new when it arrived in England. It was an L-20A, and then it was redesignated a U-6A in 1962. Before it did some time, stayed over in Europe for a time, then it went back to Davis Monthan, was surplused, I believe, in 1978. Then it went through a handful of civilian and commercial owners and until the gentleman we bought it from, and then they had bought the floats new and put it on the floats, and then I think they had a untimely death in their group of guys who were flying it, and so it just got parked, and Mike's one of those guys. He has a couple king crab fishing boats, and he just works and works and works, and I think it just got put on the back burner and kind of forgot about, and the good Lord just put us in the right place at the right time, and it found an airplane close to home that fit our budget and condition and kind of made it happen.
Outstanding. How about flying wise? I've never flown a Beaver, and like I said, we've got one Beaver pilot out here that we're going to talk to in a minute.
Yeah.
But from your standpoint, easy airplane to fly, hard airplane to fly, do you have a lot of tail dragger time?
I have a fair amount of tail dragger time, and I'll be honest with you, of course, we didn't have it on wheels, but the first time I had ever flown a Beaver was when we flew it home before the restoration, and then the first time we really flew a Beaver is when Ray and I got the checkout in it here about 4 weeks ago. A really neat guy from Seattle, Washington, named Long Nugan, and I want to tell his story real briefly. He He was from Vietnam, and he and his family were rescued out of Hanoi in a 141 when he was 10 years old. And so when he got to Seattle, he had the bug, and he wanted to be a pilot. And so this guy's a really accomplished pilot. Now he's a factory trainer for the Kodiak, for Daher, and then he does all the Citation jets, insurance, check ride, check airmen, and he does a lot of beaver instruction. So he came over, and Ray and I did our beaver checkout at the same time. And so that was really the first time I'd ever flown a beaver and on amphibs. And it flies like, it's one of the best flying airplanes you've ever flown. I mean, I compare the yoke more to like a cyclic on a helicopter, because it seems like you fly the airplane with two or three fingers. It's just the control balance is just so good, and has such good feel in it that there's just not a lot of this. It's just kind of a lot of this. And it's just really an impressive airplane. De Havilland got it right.
Well, I heard a rumor, too, that somebody else flew that airplane here, too. And so, Tyler, I got to ask the question. With a high-time pilot like yourself, what do you think of flying that thing? Was that hard, easy?
Probably the easiest airplane out there to fly.
Okay.
You get it all trimmed out, and you can just hands off, and it'll climb.
Outstanding.
We may have got spoiled, and we had Ray Fowler fly it out here. So
yeah,
you know, one of the best pilots in the land.
He's sitting out there somewhere, too. Yeah. We're not going to ask him any questions, though. but anyway, all right. I will say right now there is another L-20. I think that was designated probably an L-20 when he flew it. But Sam Bass, where is Sam Bass there? Okay. Do we have a handheld mic somewhere nearby that we could use for just a moment? There we go. You might recognize this guy. He's another one of our moderators. You'll see him later in the week. But he's been doing this a lot longer than I have. And we started talking about this yesterday. And he says, you know, I got L-20 time. And I said, huh? And I didn't know that. And so Sam told a brief story. And I'll just open it up to him for a couple brief stories maybe. But, he was a second lieutenant. Pretty much right out of pilot school, flying the C-47 over in Turkey, and they stuck him in an L-20. And Sam, I'll open it up to you right now.
Well, actually, what had happened was that I was a second lieutenant, and I had just gotten out of flying school, maybe 200 hours. And I get over to Turkey, and I'm in this place that's called JAMAT, which is Joint American Mission Military Aid to Turkey, and we were a support group. And they had radar sites up on the Black Sea, and we were to fly up there in that L-20. There was no runways, and land out there on the grass and take the mail up and whatever. And we had a straitjacket, too, that would, if somebody went bananas up there, they would sedate them, and we'd throw them in the back of the thing and take them home. I only had to do that once, which was kind of interesting. He was kind of la-la. But anyway, I got there, and the colonel called me in, and he said, I want you to go up to Samsun Trabzon on Tuesday. And I said, fine. So I get in the airplane with this other lieutenant. He's a first lieutenant. And we fly up there just primarily to show out the landmarks because there was no navigation. We fly up there, make our little triangle, come home. On Wednesday, he calls me in, the colonel. He said, well, you're going on Thursday. He said, Darryl's sick. I said, I'm not checked out in the airplane. He said, you've been in it, had you? And I said, yeah. And he said, well, you got T6 time? I said, yes, that's the same thing. So that was my checkout. And so we would fly up to Samsun Trabzon, and you took the mail up. God help you if you forgot the mail. I mean, that was the big deal. And I flew them, and I also flew them when I got back to Turkey. I was in a fighter outfit, and we had one for support. And we went deploy, we'd take that L-20 for whatever reason. I never figured out why we took it, but we did. So, but that was my L-20 experience.
Sam, before you sit down, pass it to that ugly guy behind you there. I just would like to hear his opinion of flying the airplane. He got you were the first guy to fly it after the restoration. Is that right, Ray?
I was, and much like Gary had a lot more time in it than I did. That's the first time I'd ever sat in a Beaver, so I was so impressed with the airplane. Like he said, Long that came in, that guy is a total professional, so he should have been afraid with me flying the airplane, but he sat there totally relaxed and took pictures out the window while we were flying. So it is, like Tyler said, it is such a balanced airplane. I was wondering how it would be, and I think we just turned over the 20th hour coming here to Oshkosh. So I was amazed on not only how few issues, well, actually no issues with the airplane. I mean, I think we had a little bitty brake issues as a part of the test, and that's more of the floats than the has anything to do with the restoration itself. So other than that, you know, hats off to the restoration and to obviously to everybody that did the work on it. And thank you for letting me fly in it. It's an amazing airplane.
Thanks, Ray. Back to the restoration. I'm kind of curious, Tyler, what did you work on primarily? Were you working interior, exterior, or anything and everything? Were you just a gopher?
I was kind of a little bit of everything, but towards the end, I started really working on paint.
Okay.
I did do the insulation in there, but yeah, I kind of just ran around and learned how to do everything.
And my question about the paint is, why did you decide to make it a Navy airplane?
You know, we kind of went back and forth. So we started with a balsa wood model. And Charlie and Piper and I sat at home with this balsa wood model, and we started playing with paint schemes. And we wanted to stick with a military paint scheme. You know, most amphibious beavers you see are civilian, and people kind of customize them. And we kind of go back to what we do with our museum airplanes, with the fighters and the trainers and our Stearmans and Ryans. You never know when you're going to get the opportunity to share the Warbird side of things with folks. And, if you get them to an air show or get them to the hangar, they're in that environment to where they want to hear the history, and it gives you an opportunity to share with them just how important the people were that flew these and made them, and talk about the sacrifice of the veterans. But we wanted to go military scheme because you never know, we might run into a bunch of kids out in the middle of a lake or at a beach or at a campsite, and they may ask, well, why is this Navy, or why is this his Army? And it might lead you into that conversation of the veterans and the Air Force and America and everything that, you know, why we're all able to be here today. And so that was real important that we kept it military. And then reading about its history, you know, we kept basically the Air Force, the tail on the airplane and the bands on the wing are kind of the Air Force scheme of the thing. And then believe it or not, we loved how the orange pops. So the cowling and the sides are kind of based off of a Forest Service scheme, how they paint their beavers. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, we wanted the Navy logo and the stars and bars. And so it's a little bit of a conglomerate, but the fact it was an L-20, then a U-6A, then civilian, we just tried to tie it all together, but it all went back to that balsa wood model that the girls and I played with about 19 different coats of paint, and this is what we ended up with.
Well, I appreciate you wanting to do what you've done for the veterans, and I do this every one of my presentations, and I'll just ask right now, those who are either active or are veterans or retired military, just stand up right now, please. Thank you for your service. Yep. Thank you for your service. Mm-hmm. Thanks for being here. We appreciate it greatly. Okay, so we've talked about acquiring the airplane. We talked about a little bit of what it did. And y'all probably know this thing is still actively flown by all kinds of military and civilian entities out there in the world. We talked a little bit about the restoration, talked about the motor. Interior-wise, the interior is beautiful. I mean, it is gorgeous. And it's that guy right there, you said, who made it happen?
Yeah.
Well, I take my hat off to you, because if y'all get a chance, you should take a look at the inside of this thing. My follow-on question now is, what are you going to do with it? What are you going to do? Just fly to air shows, or are you going to make
it's
family station wagon?
It's going to be our family airplane. You know, it's going to be our motor home to where we go splash around and go camping and have fun. But yet, it's something that we can still take to air shows, and they probably wouldn't mind having you around because of the military. And so we're going to use it in a variety of different. It's just going to be a real versatile airplane for us. And you know, like I said, the other airplanes are single seat. We have back seat in the Mustang, but all the other airplanes are tough, where we can load up six or seven people, and the kids and Jill and I and the girls can go have fun, and so it'll just kind of be our camper, if you will.
Okay, I'm getting into numbers now. Okay, when you say that, okay, useful load, how much can you carry with that thing?
Oh, you're going to put me on the spot, aren't you?
Okay.
About 1,300 pounds.
Okay. And how fast can you go with that thing? It's not a speed demon by any means.
No.
So, how fast?
100's probably a stretch. We figured on the way out here is between 95 and 100.
Okay.
You know, not running it real hard.
Okay.
Cruise power, you know, 28, 19 or 28, 18, 50.
Okay. And how much gas are you carrying?
95 gallons.
Okay.
So it does not have tip tanks. And so we want to, and it doesn't have the fuselage extension. So we kind of want to keep it as original as possible. And, you know, you're ready to get out after a couple hours, you know, unless you're a real serious beaver guy, you're ready to get out and stretch your legs. So the extra fuel wasn't a real big deal for us for our mission. You know, we're just goofing off with it. We're not working it hard.
Any thought of taking the pontoons off and make it a land type based only?
Not at this time. You know, we'll leave them on because most of what we do, we had to go amphibs for where we're based. There's just not a good place to leave it in the water. And, you know, the guys that really work a beaver hard, you know, they want straight floats for the heavier useful load and the higher performance. But, you know, we're just goofing off with it. So we're not packing a bunch of fish and fishermen and into the backcountry. And so the sacrifice we lose in performance with the amphibs isn't real important to us. We're actually pretty lucky in the fact we can run this propeller. This is a 22D30 AG 200 prop, which is the longest propeller you can run on a beaver, and you can't run them in a lot of areas because of the noise. It's really obnoxiously loud, which we kind of like, but in Alaska and Seattle and areas, you know, most of them are confined to a three-blade Hartzell or a shorter 6101 Hamilton standard two-blade, but Dick at Northwest Propeller had just built this prop, and so it really makes a big difference. I flew a beaver a couple weeks ago with a day's training with a three-blade Hartzell, and I was shocked at the difference, the amount of pull this propeller has compared to that. So it kind of makes up for the heavy weight of the amphibs, in our opinion.
And speaking of that, how about ground handling, you know, the amphib? Is it...
Other than feeling like you're in a lowboy tractor, you know, sitting a couple stories high. That was kind of the only thing as far as ground operation, is just getting your depth perception. You're just so much higher than anything we've ever sat in before. But other than that, it taxis and handles, you know, real great. You know, the real interesting thing about a beaver is it wasn't built to be a military airplane. You know, de Havilland, after the war, they went after building a bush plane that would open up the north, kind of like the railroad did to the west. And so that was the main mission of the airplane. But the way they went about it is how the airplane turned out so well. They got all the bush pilots in from the late 20s and early 30s that were flying all of the really antique-y stuff and said, we want to build an amazing STOL airplane. And they got a lot of input from the pilots and operators. So when the Beaver was designed, they just asked the right operators. Rather than have all the engineers sit down, they brought in the pilots and the owners and got a lot of input. And so the airplane was just, it was destined to be a good airplane because they did it right and they got a lot of input. And what was another real interesting story to tie it into the Warbird side of things is a guy by the name of Russell Banning was the test pilot for the Beaver. And I believe he was one of the highest mosquito, had more kills in a mosquito than nearly anyone in the Canadian Royal Air Force. So they had some real good guys flying it as test pilots, giving them input. And anyway, the airplane turned out, they were originally hoping to sell a couple hundred airplanes. And, you know, they ended up eventually building almost 1,700 of them, of which one order to the U.S. military was like 970 planes. So, and they said at that time to get the U.S. Air Force to buy a foreign-built airplane, there was a lot of politicking that went on. And so the airplane did such a good job, the military really wanted it. And I believe it was kind of competing against a Cessna 195 at the time for that main contract. So they just absolutely got it right when they built it. And of course you see today, you know, the Kodiak built by Quest in Idaho is probably the closest thing to try and, you know, do what the Beaver can do. And I can tell you the Kodiak's an awesome airplane. We actually have one, but it's not a Beaver.
I understand.
I still take the Beaver.
Understand. All right. Hey, let's do a quick walk around here. Don't get into too much detail. I have friends who do walk arounds and it takes them way too long as far as I'm concerned.
Okay, we'll go.
So let's just walk around briefly and just even point out some things that the folks might seem interested in.
Okay. Sounds good. Well, the first thing you see, of course, is the big prop that we just talked about, the big Ag 200 prop, 108-inch tube blade. I don't know the torque numbers off the top of my head, but you can definitely feel the difference flying the airplane. And then, of course, the original 2,200 total time 985 built by Tulsa. It's just we have a few 985s in different aircraft, and this is one of the smoothest 985s we've ever flown behind. And so there has to be something to that of where it's a low-time motor, because with the oil consumption and the way it runs, we're really tickled with that. Another thing we kind of did that was unique on the top of the floats, like I said, we're going to use this as a play machine. And so we had a company in Lewiston called Gateway Materials. We had this HydroTurf on top of the floats. And if you were working it and you were out in the oil and the grease, it probably wouldn't be the best. But where we're going to be floating in inner tubes and dropping a fishing pole or something, it kind of made the top of the floats where you're not going to get wing walk on the back of your legs and scrape your knees. But anyway, and work our way back, the prettiest part of the airplane is the interior. So if we can get up, and we tried to leave the interior, again, when you're in an amphib airplane, everyone told us weight is your real enemy. Mm-hmm. So we tried to keep the airplane really light. So we went minimal avionics. You know, the avionics are so good, and I mean, face it, there's more avionics in your phone now than you really need flying an airplane like that. So we went with the lightweight Garmin 375, which is just a GPS ADS-B in and out. And then we wanted it real simple, you know, so rather than a lot of touchscreen stuff, we went with the GTR 225s. So no comm nav, just straight comms, and you can monitor the second channel. So really you can listen to four radios. You don't need an elaborate audio panel, mm-hmm. you know, and with Bluetooth headsets and all that kind of stuff, we tried to keep it super simple. But all steam gauges, with the exception of the GI 275s for the attitude indicator and the HSI, just because of the weight, we wanted to eliminate the gyros and the vacuum pump to get rid of the weight and have that technology if we needed it. So
any engine monitor?
Pardon?
Engine monitor?
Nope, okay. We did not. I didn't want an engine monitor, to be honest with you.
Okay.
We kind of kept it old school, you know, cylinder head temp and fuel flow. And we've been really fortunate to learn from a lot of guys that, you know, one of the hardest engines to manage fuel flow and fly correctly is a 520. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we just fly it like that. We just squeak power off. You know, we're coming off an inch at a time every couple minutes. And we just, you know, gas is cheap compared to cylinders. So to try and run an engine monitor and fly it on the ragged edge, it's just not worth it. I'd rather put a little gas to it and keep cylinders. So anyway, kind of old school. So we kept as original look as we could, you know, with just a few of the new Garmin goodies to keep us safe. But anyway, can we get up and get a shot of the interior for the
yeah,
folks?
Yeah, I think so. Can cameras get up there a little bit and follow you in, or at least get a shot?
Shot of, again, Kenny. I'll close this. So again, all around instruments. So we actually. You'll notice it has one high back original military bucket on the pilot side. Mm-hmm. And we thought about doing twin military seats in the front, but we decided to go with the flip back for the co-pilot just in case you had an accident in the water and had a gear down landing or ended up upside down. I felt you wanted that egress.
Yep.
If someone had to get from the front to the back or the back to the front to help, if you had those two high back military seats there, it'd be a bit of a picket fence to try and crawl through upside down in the water. So mm-hmm. we kind of went with the low back seat for the co-pilot.
Mm-hmm.
Then
are they fairly comfortable?
They actually are. I mean, Kenny just did a magnificent job with the seats. And, of course, you know, the original military seats are built for parachutes.
Yeah.
So you take up that cavity with foam. And so they're actually, I think Ray would agree, they're actually really comfortable seats.
Mm-hmm.
And then in the back, we've got it set up for three passengers in the middle row, and then we've got the original hammock suspended, you know, two passenger hammock seat in the back, which is probably the most comfortable seat in it. And then Bill rebuilt all the floors with brand new micarta and routed them all out off the factory floors. And then we had the same HydroTurf that are on top of the floats are just Kenny put them on top of old trunk mat that was real nice and soft that wouldn't score the micarta, and then they're just Velcroed down, just basically as floor mats, if you will. So when we go out and we crawl in it with sandy feet, we're not scratching up the floor. And Mm-hmm. I'm sure those won't stay perfect for too awful long, but thought it'd be kind of fun originally. The other thing is when we got the airplane, it was a single yoke airplane without brakes on the co-pilot side. And we wanted to be able to, of course, it's easier to learn in the airplane and then let people fly. And so we found a new old stock dual yoke that came out of Saudi Arabia and a dual control rudder bar with rudder pedals that came in crates from de Havilland from the 50s that a guy in Canada had. And so we converted over to the dual yoke and the dual rudder bar. So that was another pretty big project. And that's what the guys like to call one of my change orders when we're trying to get it done on a time frame, and all of a sudden we change our mind and want to change yokes and rudder bars. But they just jumped in and got it done right away. So
how about ventilation? How hot does it get in there?
You know, it was pretty hot when we trained, when Ray came out. And, you know, with the two big vents up above your head, and then, of course, we did add, you know, all the original military beavers had four skylights, and then a lot of people took them out. We actually put two back in. It's a Kenmore STC. You know, and we fly it. We live in Lewiston, Idaho, so we're at the gateway to Hell's Canyon, which is the deepest canyon in North America. It's deeper than the Grand Canyon. And so we do a lot of flying in the Hell's Canyon area where you're looking up and looking at the top of the cliffs and the hills, and so the skylights are really awesome for that. To be able to get good visibility out the top of the airplane. But we added the vent windows here after we test flew it. That made a big difference. And we haven't slid the windows down yet because we wanted to keep them kind of clean for the show. But I think once you're able to open the windows and the vents, it's not bad. And like I say, Bill made these custom UHMW stops for the rear door. And then Brian Norris hooked us up with these really cool stop kit that he makes on the front doors. So you can run around on the water taxiing with the doors open, and you're not doing any damage to the doors or the fuselage. So you can get a lot of airflow, you know, before you're ready to take off. And so it's actually pretty comfortable. You know, it's not that bad.
Float's in pretty good shape. You didn't have too much leakage with them or anything like that?
You know, believe it or not, the floats were nearly brand new. They put the airplane's never been in salt. They put the airplane on these new whip floats pretty not too long before they parked it. And so the floats were nearly like new. And even, you know, we sealed them up and kind of went through them the best we could. And we just had just a tiny leak around one of the spreader bars because we just hadn't sealed the spreader bars up yet. And so they run really, really dry. And then whip, we updated it with the new whip duck bills that stay in so we can run our pump on top of those. But so far they've been really great.
Okay, let's keep walking around and then we'll open it up to a few questions here.
Okay, sounds good. You know, as far as the military stenciling, there's really nothing to go by because there wasn't a military beaver on amphibs that we could really draw from, so we just kind of did the stenciling based off how we did the other airplanes.
Yep.
That's the original military contract order number 52, of course, representing the year, and then 6138. And so, of course, we just, you know, stenciled the fuel bay and the baggage and original. We definitely wanted, I got a shout out to Connie, so we definitely wanted some type of warning for the propeller just because you're going to be around people that haven't been around airplanes a lot if you're at the beach or at the lake. So we actually took the warnings off of the Tiger Cat that Connie flew a few years ago. We were really struggling with what kind of warning, and you know, some beavers don't have warning. Some have massive red warning stripes. Some have different. And so we actually kiped that off one of the Tiger Cats that Connie flew a couple years ago. And so that was some of those stencils. I wish we could uncowl it because actually the prettiest part of the airplane is with it unbuttoned. It actually looks better with the cowling off. Like I said, when Bill did the bird cage, of course the bird cage is this entire structure from the front of the wing to the motor mount, and it encompasses all your rudder bar, your controls, everything for your dash. It's actually a 15-year calendar item that you have to either replace, or I don't think it's NDT, or test after 15 years every year. And so it's a big item on a beaver, and so that was a big job replacing that. And when he did, he handmade his own firewall, so the firewall is polished. And all the foot stirrups are polished, and you know, just when we rigged it with the motor, we tried to make sure every line and hose was clocked right with the AN fitting. And so anything that has to do with fuel is painted red. Anything that has to do with oil is painted yellow down to the last fitting tube. all the scat tubes and the cooling tubes for the mags, everything's polished, and so it was really kind of fun to do some neat detail there.
What's max gross weight?
This one's 5180.
Okay.
We don't have any of the increases on it.
Okay.
And the airplane, I think the empty weight on scales was, I believe, 3985. It was just under 4,000 pounds, which, you know, we don't know enough. All our beaver friends said that's really good for an amphib, but I'm sure there's people here that know a lot more about that than we do. But but anyway, just a lot of tried to pay a lot of attention to detail if we could through the stenciling and, you know, the little tiny things, the door bracketry and the latches, and tried to heat shrink tube all the bungees and things like that to finish it off nice. And of course, the most important thing is that American flag on the tail. That's the best part.
I see your landing light too. Have you landed this at night?
Haven't landed at night.
How about Ray? Did you land at night? Nope. Okay. Nope. Just wondering.
And then the main reason for the LED lights are for the pulsating, the wigwag lights, they call it, for visibility. You know, and that was the other reason we wanted the bright colors, is you're going in on lakes and or rivers that, you know, a lot of boats aren't familiar with airplanes. You want to be seen.
Absolutely.
And, you know, the last thing we want to do is not be seen in the air. And so that was a lot of the reason with going with the LED lights and the bright colors.
Okay. All right. Tell you what, let's open up to questions right now. Hey, they're fair game. If anybody's got any kind of question, it looks like Ray's got a question already down here. So go ahead, Mr. Fowler.
There's always that guy.
Not so much as a question, but would you talk a little bit about what you're building in Lewiston, particularly the fleet and kind of a destination part? Because that's spectacular as well. So I'm sure they would love to hear about some of the other airplanes and really what, hopefully, if they come through Lewiston, Idaho, what they're probably going to see in the next few years as a part of the museum.
Sure. Thanks, Ray, for that. So the name of our organization is Hangar 180, and it's just made up of, you know, it takes a team to operate these aircraft, as you know. And so we wanted something, and the Hangar 180 actually came. Our first old airplane was a PT-22 Ryan in 2008. And then we own a 1929 Stearman Model 4 Speedmail that was flown by Charles Lindbergh in 1931. And it was the first airplane that was bought by the Ridgefield Oil Company, which was John D. Rockefeller's main competitor on the West Coast. So it's kind of a special airplane to us. And so as a shout out to Lindbergh and Lindbergh Field and Claude Ryan and the PT-22, we also have a Ryan STA and a Ryan STM. So the Ryan collection is real precious to us. And when Claude Ryan built the Spirit of St. Louis for Charles Lindbergh, he built it in San Diego at the Ryan Aircraft Company, which is now Lindbergh Field, but he built it in building 180. And that was so that's kind of where we came up with the Hangar 180, is kind of a subtle shout out to them. But
yeah.
But we're in the process of building a flying museum. Everything we own flies. We have about 15 aircraft. We have the Stearman is the oldest airplane, the 1929, and then the Ryans. We have the 1933 STA. The Ryan STM is probably one of our rarest airplanes that was actually a Warbird. It was training the Indian Air Force in Jakarta, India, and was smuggled out of a hull of a ship in the middle of a Japanese bombing raid to Australia. And then it spent time training the Royal Australian Air Force before the Japanese got further south. And so the STA, the STM, and then, of course, when we officially got in the war, the PT-22. We have a PT-13, a nice original PT-13 with a 225 like, and then a P-64 replica, which, you know, as many of you know, was one of the founder EA's favorite airplane, and the only original P-64 is over in the museum, and there's about 10 replicas floating around the world, and it's one of our favorite airplanes, believe it or not. It's our main ride giver and workhorse. It's kind of it's a hot rod T-6, basically, And then we have a P-40 that was built by John Fallis in Lafayette, Louisiana. Its name's Susie. You've maybe seen her flying around or in some of the social media stuff. And then our last airplane is our Mustang that we acquired a few years ago, and it's finished out as the Patty Ann 2, which is a 352nd Blue Nose airplane. And so we're trying to put together a flying museum. We fly pretty frequently. We have, like I said, we have an amazing group of talented pilots. Ray's a huge part of that. The Plains of Fame have been a big supporter of us with the Hintons and Johnny Maloney and Robbie Patterson. They come up and fly with us when we have events. And Mike Brashears has brought up Dottie May to Lewiston a couple times, the P-47. So yeah, we're trying to build something special. Lewiston's an amazing place. For those of you that haven't been there, we're really blessed to live in an incredible area. And if anybody get out west in the Pacific Northwest, come see us.
I heard you had an interesting airplane painted up. It was a King Air, as I remember. Could you tell that quick story?
Well, so last year, of course, you'll see Bud Anderson here today or tomorrow.
Tomorrow afternoon,
which is incredible. Bud is a just one of our cherished friends. And last year for the Nampa Warhawk Museum, Bud's not traveling quite as much as he was, and this was going to be one of his last events. And so we wanted to do something really special for him. And so we got together with Ray and kind of surprised him. So we wrapped our King Air like the old Crow Mustang and picked Bud up in Auburn, California. And then Ray coordinated the two old Crows from Michigan, which he just flew in this morning. And then another friend of ours from Houston, James Bohannon, who has the Glamorous Glenn, which was Chuck Yeager's Mustang. And of course, for those of you who don't know, Chuck and Bud flew their very last mission together. And so Bud had no idea this was going on. Ray and his crew were in Wendover. We left Auburn. We picked a little point out in Oregon to rendezvous. And typical Ray fashion, I made it about 180 degrees through a left turn, and all of a sudden there's three Mustangs on our wing. And Jim said, "Hey, Dad, look out the window." And here was two old Crows and Glamorous Glenn. So it was really fun.
And a King Air in the same paint scheme.
And a King Air in the paint. Yeah, it was really a fun trip. Well,
thank you for that. All right, other questions out there? We got anybody else who wants to ask questions of the owner, the restorers, the flyers, et cetera? No? Okay.
Absolutely. Yeah. This airplane literally had no squawks when we got done. I mean, we put the original brake lines that came with the new old stock kit, and we had some brake hose issues with it. And by the time Ray and I went home and got back to flight the next morning, Bill had already replaced all of that and taken care of it. It literally had zero squawks. Wow. After a ground up. So, yeah.
That's called attention to detail is what that's called.
Yeah,
and Bill, I compliment you and Tyler also for your part in it all, because that's what it takes, you know. All right, other questions? Cruise speed?
95 to 100, you know, just depends how hard you want to run it there. You know, when we bought it, everyone said it's 90, 90, 90. That's what it is. They're not too far off. So, but we were surprised. Of course, Ray must live right, because we had a tailwind the whole way out here, which is really rare. But probably about 95 to 100.
How about gallons per hour?
At 25.
Okay.
Yeah, cruise. You know, you're higher than that, obviously, for takeoff. But if you figure 25, you're real close.
Okay.
Hey, Gary, tell them about the cruise flaps.
Yeah, the airplane just loves flaps. In fact, you don't do anything without flaps. You know, the airplane is so big, and you can see those big flaps, and they actually droop the ailerons as well. But, you know, if you're in, depending what the winds are doing, if you have it heavy, And the airplane's kind of got an aft CG. I mean, you just reach down. It's got manual. We kept the manual flaps. We didn't go to electric flaps. Mm-hmm. You just give it a couple pumps of flap, and it just sets the airplane up, and you take off. And so a lot of times it's a little bit faster with some flap, believe it or not. But anything you do in the Beaver wants flaps. And, you know, I've had a lot of people tell me that have a lot of Beaver experience say that's one of the only ways you can really hurt yourself in a Beaver is to not have enough flap in to do some tight turns, either to scout out an area or see someone. So you're on the flap lever nonstop. I mean, everything you're doing is a change of flap.
Mm-hmm. All right, anything else? All right, with that, I think we're going to wrap it up. And I'm going to say, first of all, thank you, Gary. Yeah,
thank you, Ed.
For
Appreciate
your acquisition and your flying skills. Bill, thank you for your job. Tyler, same thing.
Yeah. Thanks for having us.
You bet.
And thank all of you for listening.
Yeah, thank you all for being here. And just a quick shout out too. The rest of the week, we've got some very interesting programs. As Gary said, we've got Bud tomorrow afternoon. This afternoon, we got a Sea Fury. Sam's going to be taking care of that. Let's see. Tomorrow morning, I do believe we've got the Jerry Yagan, and he's got a P-40, and a mosquito is going to be here tomorrow morning. Wednesday is the day of the cats. That's one you may not want to miss. We've got, a wildcat, a hellcat, two tiger cats, and a bear cat that are going to be out here. Thursday, and that afternoon, we're going to have two ME-109s on the ramp out here, which will be very interesting also. We've got, Bud Anderson, like I said, tomorrow afternoon, we've got a veterans, I don't know, to me it's going to be a big deal, on Saturday morning, a major retired, Lucky Luckadoo, is going to be here. If you haven't read his book, you need to. It's called Damn Lucky, B-17 pilot from World War II, got his 25 missions and survived, and he's going to be here, and we're going to interview Lucky on Saturday morning. So with that, I'll say thank you very much. Again, I compliment all you on a beautiful, beautiful airplane. And folks, if you want to walk around and ask some more questions, these guys are going to be hanging out here for a little while. So thank you for being here, and thanks for coming to Oshkosh.
Flying, keep 'em in the sky, keep 'em flying, hitting hard and high. On every lip, the fervent cry, keep 'em flying, Uncle Sam. Keep 'em flying, every headline screams, keep 'em flying. Army fighting teams on 30,000 different beams, keep 'em flying, Uncle Sam.
We were made for grass, made to feel the joy of each and every blade, between our toes, across our backs, to run over its hills, marvel at its beauty, and find comfort in its stillness. We were made for grass, It's where we battled and celebrated, built monuments, grew families, forged memories, and pushed ourselves farther than ever before. We were made for grass, to care for, nurture, and cultivate. We've always made sure to have a patch of our own, because there's no greater feeling than being on the grass. Except leaving it.
I guess I was fairly apprehensive the whole time that I was flying in combat, and I guess there's good reason to feel that way. I'm there to cause a lot of damage and a lot of harm, and therefore they would like to damage me. And I was 25 years old at that time. Top Gun was really a thrill. I must have done well in actual combat because at the time I was just a lieutenant junior grade, which is a first lieutenant in the Air Force. And so I may have been the very first lieutenant junior grade to go through Top Gun. That was the dream of a lifetime come true. I had wanted to be an aeronautical engineer and a test pilot, just like my dad, from the time I was 10 years old. STS-27 was my third launch. And it was only the second launch after the Challenger accident. We were a top secret, classified Department of Defense mission. So to this day, if I told you what we carried, you could never leave this hangar. You'd be... Well, I will never forget. We maneuvered the arm, and Mike Mullane was my arm operator. So he moved the arm over there, and we brought up the television image of the right wing. And I looked at what I was seeing, and I said to myself, we are going to die. To be an airline pilot, there was mandatory age 60 retirement. I was a NASA astronaut until I was 50 years old. And so I looked at the situation, and I had known a number of Southwest airline pilots. And they were just like me. They were flying because they loved to fly. There's a lot of piloting that goes into it, a tremendous amount of piloting that goes into it, because you're going to wind up passing other airplanes. You're going to get in a duel with another airplane that's fairly closely matched. So there's a ton of satisfaction from doing that. And, hey, let's just talk about the racing itself. It's fun to fly low, but it's dangerous. And so the only time I fly low is at the Reno Air Races. But watching the ground go by you at 400 and 500 miles an hour is pretty darn thrilling, because it's really scooting on by. And that's fun. That's really fun. I had always been fascinated by racing planes because they're sleek, streamlined, and they go real fast. There's that need for speed again, and they're raced around a pylon. And so I determined that I could break the existing altitude record for altitude and horizontal flight for that quarter category of airplane. And in fact, I did that in 1991. Fond of saying that if I have done well as an aviator, it's because my dad was the one who taught me how to fly. And he didn't just teach me how to fly, he taught me the why of it as well. He taught me the aerodynamics behind it, the reasons that you're doing things, not just how to do it, but why you're doing it is also very important.
Flying, keep 'em in the sky, keep 'em flying, hitting hard and high. On every lip the fervent cry, keep 'em flying, Uncle Sam. Keep 'em flying, every headline screams, keep 'em flying, Army fighting teams. On 30,000 different beams, keep 'em flying, Uncle Sam.
We were made for grass. Made to feel the joy of each and every blade. Between our toes, across our backs. To run over its hills, marvel at its beauty, and find comfort in its stillness. We were made for grass. It's where we battled and celebrated. Built monuments, grew families, forged memories, and pushed ourselves farther than ever before. We were made for grass, to care for, nurture, and cultivate. We've always made sure to have a patch of our own, because there's no greater feeling than being on the grass. Except leaving it.
I guess I was fairly apprehensive the whole time that I was flying in combat. And I guess there's good reason to feel that way. I'm there to cause a lot of damage and a lot of harm, and therefore they would like to damage me. And I was 25 years old at that time. Top Gun was really a thrill. I must have done well in actual combat because at the time I was just a lieutenant junior grade, which is a first lieutenant in the Air Force. And so I may have been the very first lieutenant junior grade to go through Top Gun. That was the dream of a lifetime come true. I had wanted to be an aeronautical engineer and a test pilot, just like my dad, from the time I was 10 years old. STS-27 was my third launch. And it was only the second launch after the Challenger accident. We were a top secret, classified Department of Defense mission. So to this day, if I told you what we carried, you could never leave this hangar. You'd be... Well, I will never forget. We maneuvered the arm, and Mike Mullane was my arm operator. So he moved the arm over there, and we brought up the television image of the right wing. And I looked at what I was seeing, and I said to myself, we are gonna die. to be an airline pilot, there was mandatory age 60 retirement. I was a NASA astronaut until I was 50 years old. And so I looked at the situation, and I had known a number of Southwest airline pilots. And they were just like me. They were flying because they loved to fly. There's a lot of piloting that goes into it, a tremendous amount of piloting that goes into it, because you're going to wind up passing other airplanes. You're going to get in a duel with another airplane that's fairly closely matched. So there's a ton of satisfaction from doing that. And, hey, let's just talk about the racing itself. It's fun to fly low, but it's dangerous. And so the only time I fly low is at the Reno Air Races. But watching the ground go by you at 400 and 500 miles an hour is pretty darn thrilling, because it's really scooting on by. And that's fun. That's really fun. Been fascinated by racing planes because they're sleek, streamlined, and they go real fast. There's that need for speed again, and they're raced around a pylon. And so I determined that I could break the existing altitude record for altitude and horizontal flight for that quarter category of airplane. And in fact, I did that in 1991. Fond of saying that if I have done well as an aviator, it's because my dad was the one who taught me how to fly. And he didn't just teach me how to fly, he taught me the why of it as well. He taught me the aerodynamics behind it, the reasons that you're doing things, not just how to do it, but why you're doing it is also very important.
Keep 'em flying, Uncle Sam.